Hey guys, it's Big Mike, and like always, I'd like to thank you for being here today. Today we welcome back Linda Bradford Raschke, and she is here to talk about several things, in fact, including how to determine the type of day, talk about Taylor trading technique, finding the ideal trade location, and much more. Also, this webinar is part of our four-year anniversary. We've got 16 very special webinars all month long, five more to go this week, and then we're through. And during all those webinars, we've been giving away some really fantastic prizes, including this webinar. We're giving away 10 autographed books that Linda has selected. The title of the book is The Complete Works of Florence Scovel Shinn, and hopefully I pronounced that correctly. So Linda has asked that we hold questions until the end of the presentation, and then we're also going to be giving away those 10 books once we're done with that. A quick reminder that all webinars are recorded, and I will post the recording of this on YouTube sometime tomorrow. Okay, guys, give me 1 second, and I'm going to turn things over to Linda.
Okay, we're ready to rock and roll. Thank you, Mike, for having me on here, and this is my second time presenting to this group, and first of all, congratulations, Mike, on four long and grueling years of putting together quite a tremendous website and quite a lot of content for traders out there that's both of educational value and that proverbial word, free. So with that, let's move on. Last time when I did a presentation, we actually did a completely different type of topic, which was drilling down onto the intraday charts for short-term volume spikes and volume divergences, and just seeing different ways of looking at data. And this is for very, very short-term day trading, or possibly ideas for systematic trading execution and so forth. And now we're going to completely do an about face, and I'm going to show you what I really spend my time on more than anything, and have for pretty much 30 years, as well as the things that have influenced my trading. First, quickly, please respect all the copyright notices, because I do use the charts of the Photon Trader, CQG, and TradeStation for this presentation. Thank you all to them. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to start off and look at a little bit of a daily top-down approach. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you exactly how I do my homework and my game plan each day, and the things that have worked for me most consistently over the years. And this is what I've used for my hedge fund and my CTA since 1991. And the nice thing about it is that it's not such short-term scalping. You can actually move a lot of size on it, but you can take these same concepts and use them just for a day trade as well. So hopefully I'll show you enough pros and cons to different approaches and techniques. Number two, exactly what I do. And lastly, thirdly, give you ideas to research on your own, because I feel pretty strongly in this business that unless you develop your own ideas and study this for yourself, it's not ever going to be of any value. And I cringe the more I've seen more and more, quote, educators regurgitate other people's information and so forth without doing the proper statistical testing or analysis. And it's doing everybody a disservice. So anyway, please, anytime you look at something, oops, I'm going to back up here, make it your own. You know, research it, see when it works and when it doesn't work. I'll show you all my statistics and my quantitative testing. Don't take it at face value, because the markets can change at any time, of course. And when you do your own research, that's where you start to really learn the little nuances where it's going to be of value for you. So the way I start is I've always started with a 310 oscillator on the daily chart. And I'll be the first to tell you that oscillators do not model out in any of our systems or for quantitative structure, but they're extremely useful in helping highlight chart formations. And these, as you see, are very important in the big scheme of things. So if you were to Google security market research, SMR, you'd see the service. This is a charting service that I started getting in 1981. And the value of it was that we had to plot the daily things by hand, each bar by hand, and then at night I could call up on a hotline number and get this fast and slow line to plot or draw in by hand. And it was about 10 years later that I actually found out what that was, and it was this 310 moving average oscillator. With that said, it's just there to support what the eye sees only. And the reason I'm starting off with these daily bar charts is not necessarily because that's where the bulk of my trading is or my work departs from, but they're very important in two ways of understanding. And the first is that, number one, the choice daily formations that lead to position trades really do not happen as often as we think they do, okay? So there's a lot of noise in between, and that's where we're really going to drill down and look at the 2 to 3 day cycle, if you will, that Taylor highlighted, you know, up 1, 2, 3 days, down 1, 2, 3 days. So the choice daily chart formations really don't happen that often. However, it is important to put things into context. So I always start off looking at the daily and the weekly chart formations, and it doesn't take more than you know, a minute to glance at it for each market. I usually trade about 24 different markets, so I can't have work that takes more than a minute to look at. And what you see here is just the daily, weekly charts of the S&Ps, and right now we had weekly sell divergences on numerous global indices, the transports, etc. So that's sort of been the predominant theme here, is that we're in this cycle where the weeklies correct back down, and that's how I foresee this structure. And then on the daily charts, you can see, of course, we put in our first lower high. So technically, these daily charts are still in an uptrend per se, but you're doing an ABC type of formation down, and of course it could eventually turn into a more significant downtrend, but for now this ABC down, and we've got the weeklies also correcting back down. And something that I'll show you a little bit later on, one of the things that I really like about these oscillators is that I always monitor the slow line here, so you can see the slow line represents the higher time frame fast line. So you can see how the weekly fast line here has corrected back down, you see, so this would be equivalent to that. But now on the weekly charts, you've got a broader cycle at work where this, once again, this slow line on the weeklies can continue to work back down. So that means, you know, the way I would interpret that is that we could be in a little bit of a sloppy environment for weeks to come, but the beautiful thing about Taylor is finding the trading opportunities in both directions. And here's another type of classic chart formation. The reason you would want to be aware of something like this, obviously, is that A, you know, it does lend itself to a position trade. B, these types of things set up again once a quarter, so you need to have another stable way of making bread and butter as you're waiting for these formations to develop. And just about all of the daily, weekly type of position trades will come from using the two time frames. The weeklies, of course, had a trend reversal in that they had two higher lows, very, very powerful, and this was, of course, you know, a choice little wedge. Now, the reason we also want to identify these types of formations, in addition to having the opportunity of putting on a position trade, is for something that we'll look at later, cases where you get persistency of trend or an extended run, which is actually going to be the second half of my talk today. So even though I'm by nature a trader of this 1 to 2 days, 3 day, you know, 3 day cycle, you know, up and down, or looking for the buy or the sell short day type of play, I love doing the overnight trades, you know, buy one day, exit the next day, etc. The reason why it's so important to identify the cases or the points where we can have these extended runs, which are cases where you get multiple closes on one side of a 5-period simple moving average. That's how I've quantified it, and I'll show you the foundation of that in the second half of this presentation. But once again, you know, for swing traders, you don't want to be getting run over, looking to buy too soon or short too soon when you're going to get one of those periods where you get, you know, 10 days up in a row. And I think that what people don't realize is that these cases of getting, you know, 10 higher highs or 10 lower lows in a row are actually much more frequent than you would think in the market data. So I look at them and I call them extended runs, and their frequency of occurrence is actually about 9 or 10 times a year per market. So it's really important to look at these things. And if you want to take it one step further, then you can start to research the conditions that precede these extended runs. So the extended run, I'm I'm quantifying it by saying you've had 7 closes on one side of a daily 5 SMA. And one of the conditions that actually precedes this extended run type of environment, and we'll see how to do that, is the breakout from these chart formations. So that's why I start off with this as a departure point, because if you're swing trading and looking to buy or short every 2 or 3 days, the very first thing you would want to know is what is our filter for when not to do that. And if you know how to stay out of trouble, the rest of it all falls into place. Okay, so that's my overall general introduction there. Just a few notes about the swing trading concepts. And by swing trading, I'm simply talking about one leg at a time. So you know you could have a swing trade on a 5-minute chart and it could last a duration for 30 minutes. And you could have a swing trade on a weekly chart that could last a duration for 5 weeks. So it's a little bit confusing semantics, you know, and so it's really the concept of just taking one leg at a time. So for our purposes today, we're just going to simply look at a 2 to 3 day type of time frame, which actually coincides very nicely with a 120 minute or a 240 minute type of chart. And we'll see both the pattern recognition that form, how we can quantify certain conditions, and then lastly, how do we trade them? So several ingredients to this component here. When I do my homework at night, I'm always approaching the market with a bias. Do the odds favor a high to low day or a low to high day? Because as a shorter term trader, the most important thing for you should be the trend for the day. Okay, and the trend for the day is always measured off of the opening price. So obviously you can be in a downtrending market, have a large gap down, immediately start to trend up off the opening price, and the trend for the day is up even though you might end up down on the day. But for a short-term time frame, we always want to reference the opening price in order to determine the trend for the day. And then it's a matter of alternation. Some days are rotation days. Some days are in that market profile vernacular, a test and reject type of day. And then other days are purely directional biased days. So what I'm trying to do in my nightly preparation is simply keep it 2 to 3 words. Am I looking to be a buyer the next day, or am I looking to be a short seller the next day? And always with the goal of, if I get the cycle right, can I hold it overnight? Now, obviously, in a strong downtrending market, for example, we could have a buy day because we've been 4 days down and overextended, and Taylor would say, buy the flush of the previous day's low, the penetration, but then look to exit it as you come back up to that low. So I call those scalp-only days, which means that you want to be out by the close. But one of the big secrets is there's a significant edge in holding things overnight. So I'm always looking for the setups. Where do the odds favor me having 65% chance or greater of overnight follow-through? And that's been, I think, a huge influence from Taylor. Don't worry, I think you will have all these slides later. I posted a lot of extra material if you want to go back and read them. But I just want to get through these main concepts. So in addition to those daily chart structures and you know, the little oscillator to sort of support if we're making a lower high, or if there's a triangle, or you know, a buyer-sell divergence type of a longer-term picture. The second thing that I use for the approaching the Taylor work is I've always used this 2-period rate of change. And I had a friend who was worked for Hewlett-Packard, you know, 15 years ago, who said, you know, the reason that that is so far superior to a 1-period rate of change is something about the noise frequency signal stuff nonsense. And you can see that I'm obviously not an engineer because I can only partially regurgitate what he was explaining to me with this noise signal, I don't know, ratio and so forth. But the fact of the matter is that I spent quite a number of years testing out this two-period rate of change in assorted systems or follow-through or modeling with Steve Moore of Moore Research Center, and it was about the only momentum indicator or oscillator, if you want to call it that, where I did find an edge, a statistically significant edge. So that greatly influenced me, and I found that that's pretty much held up over time. The second thing is, you know, as long as we're using this directional thing, the second thing that we model is there a three-bar coil or a breakout type of formation where we really can't predict the direction with any certainty? And another thing that greatly influenced my trading was volatility breakout systems. And this was a pretty powerful concept for me. I remember many, many years ago, I think it was in 1991 or 1992, I had a friend, Bob Buran, who introduced me to his system, and we traded that on and off throughout the years for a number of times, and I'll tell you the pros and cons of some of these mechanical systems and what I learned from that. I learned something from every different style and system I trade, but what I learned was two things. First of all, there is a significant power in riding that range expansion. It's and capturing the trend for the day. And you have to keep in mind that where I was coming from was a pit trader in the 80s. And you know, a pit trader is always fade, fade, fade. You know, the market rallies, you're selling because everybody wants to buy from you, and the market's selling off, and you end up buying because everybody wants to sell to you. And what invariably happens on these trend days is that you can get buried, you know, if you start to average or things like that. And I'm sure everybody has been there in their trading education. And so it was one of the few tools that I could latch onto that made me feel powerful that I could capture a trend day and not get run over, but actually participate in it. And then understand the odds, because the volatility breakout system always held the trades overnight, that there is overnight follow-through more often than not. Of course, not always, but our modeling showed more often than not. So that's what I learned from the volatility breakout system. We don't trade it mechanically anymore, and I had to quit trading it for the fund, because one of the drawbacks is that you just can't move any significant size when you're always entering in the direction that the market's moving, and moving quickly. And so we started to get too much friction and deterioration and slippage, and I think that's a problem with any of the large funds that try to do this trading on a one or two day type of time frame. So there's pros and cons to a lot of systems, and I'll go into some of those more, but very educational experience for me, something that I believe in, these volatility breakout systems, and understanding how to go with the market. For example, if you have a breakout of the first 30-minute bar or a breakout of the first hour's range, is something that's almost counterintuitive once you've been a swing trader and you get very addicted to looking for the turning points, you know. And So that was one tool that actually helped us a lot. And then lastly, the other thing was this concept of the extended run. So I know what happens too is that the markets start selling, and you know, it's very easy to say, oh, you know, it's gone a little bit too far. It should have a reaction back up, and the odds are just so far against you. So I'll show you how I incorporate that as well with this Taylor rhythm of 2 to 3 days. So when we look at this in a little bit more detail, you know, there's several ways that you can incorporate Taylor's work or his words, his philosophical words, into your own work. And as an aside, when I chose this topic, I did not realize that for some reason it does not seem that the Taylor book is available on the internet right now. It's a flimsy little $25 publication that you can't read half of it anyway, because he's such a lousy author, all right? And I saw one copy on Amazon for a ridiculously absorbent price, and it's just simply not worth it. I guarantee if you Google Taylor Trading or whatever, you'll find stuff on it, and I believe I've got stuff on my website that goes into a lot more detail on it. The main things you'll get from my talk today, the essence of what it is today. But a couple ways we can trade it is, first of all, if you do have Taylor's book or you have read him, you see that he creates his little book method. And you can do something like that, totally rigid, and follow it mechanically. It's tape reading on the entries and tape reading on the exits, but it's a very systematic approach to the market. And that was his way of dealing with the noise, because it was very easy to get caught up in the cross currents of 5-minute charts and 1-minute charts and all kinds of noise. And his approach was like, okay, if I just look to make one trade a day, and if I just hit that one trade a day right 50% of the time, and my wins are going to be much bigger than my losses, and I'll know when I have the wrong idea. And it's very easy to manage our trades and say, nope, you know, it's not going to be a buy day today. That's what he proved through his records of his trading. The next way that you can use this, and this is the way that I like to do it, as I sort of cherry pick to a recognizable pattern. There's several key recognizable patterns that I have that I will show you. Some we can quantify and some we can't. For example, Friday's close, I had a strong signal actually to short the close of Friday because it was the day after new momentum lows on the two-period rate of change. And so we can quantify that and say, okay, if I short the close on the day after these big new momentum lows on the two-period rate of change, it's a huge positive expectation for a downward bias. So certain points we can quantify, other points we can't. Now, there's two problems with trading little selective pick-and-choose things. Okay, the first is that the pickier you are about something, the trade frequency goes way down. So, in other words, if I said I'm only going to trade just this one little pattern on the S&Ps, your trade frequency is going to go down because your frequency of occurrence is much lower. But on the other hand, if we're doing it across a basket of, say, 20 different markets, I find that every day I have four or five, at least six, key setups, and if I just capture two or three of those the next day, I've got a pretty consistent approach to the market. So that's one way that you can do it. Another way that you can do it is we have actually traded these in a mechanical system. The problem with a mechanical system is that you do need to use much wider stops for a system, otherwise you'll get tagged. But on the other hand, you can trade 20 different markets at once, and that's a limitation that we have to realize when we are picking our style of trading, is that we're human and you can't day trade or tape read 20 different markets at once. It's obviously impossible. So you know, all of these are things to think about, your own temperament and what's going to work for you. And then lastly, let's say that we're just index traders, because I was just an S&P futures trader ever since the very first day they traded on the floor. I think that was back in 1982, I believe. And for about 8 years, I didn't trade any other futures, only the S&P futures. And I was still trading stock options. And then slowly I added in the financials and so forth. So I had a period there where I just was doing this on the S&Ps. And back in those days, our average daily range for the S&Ps could be just four handles. And so you didn't really have that same opportunity or play that we have in the length of line that we have today. And you understand what I'm saying when I say length of line. That's if you took all the swings and you unfolded them into one big long string. Okay, the length of line in the S&Ps, in other words, the play that it has during the day is probably greater than most other markets. Most other markets, such as the you know, the hogs or the beans or, you know, even some of the softs, the sugar, you know, pretty much are going to trade you know, low to high for the day or high to low for the day without so much intraday opportunity as we see in the S&Ps. Okay, so let's just go on, and then we start to see some charts, and we'll put this into play. And let me just add one last time, don't take anything I say for granted. Do your own work. Don't buy another person's system. Don't listen to anybody else without sitting there and then verifying it for yourself. And there's just no substitute for doing this type of research yourself. And this is where I feel like I've really developed my edge over the years, is I've eat, sleep, and breathe this, and hopefully I can share some of these nuances that I have found over the years with you. And I know that they're transferable because I see other people taking my same work and work that I've taught at a conference or something and applying it, or even teaching it and doing it consistently. So that's the important thing with any methodology, is it transferable? And that person that then is applying your work, are they applying it consistently? And the answer is almost yes. It's very easy to do. So in that regards, it's like market profile, okay? You could teach market profile to a person, and if they've understood the concepts and practiced it and get it, you know, when you've got the, you know, moves out of these balance areas or the reversion back to the mean type of thing, you know, with time and seeing it over and over, they can probably come up with nearly identical analysis that you come up with. And that's what's really important in a consistent methodology, and that is what I have found with the Taylor thing. So I have not seen any change to it over the years, and I'll show you some cool little things that show that even though we have 24-hour markets, it won't make a difference in the long run how we approach this. So just real quickly, we'll start looking at some charts, and what I've got here is a two-period rate of change plotted on the bonds, a daily bond chart, and this five-period simple moving average here, and this is just a random 20-period exponential moving average. Okay, so a couple things that I want to point out right away is that we're using daily bars as our departure point. Okay, daily bars is our departure point, and this two-period rate of change, because that's where I could get our statistical modeling. And when we've used this in mechanical systems, I actually found that we can do just fine initiating on the closing price or waiting till the evening reopening. So a lot of our mechanical systems actually initiate in the evening session. And that's where we're measuring our opening of the bar, as is traditional nowadays. However, I want you to respect the fact that it really doesn't matter if you come in on the 7 a.m. reading. I'm going to show you why and how it still applies regardless of whether you were there for the opening or of the nightly bar or not. And obviously last night's a good example. Today was supposed to have a downward bias, and even though a good part of the initial sell-off happened overnight, there was still plenty of opportunity in the morning to make a trade from the short side, and the market closed weak as it was. So a couple things that I'm going to look for with the bonds, okay, or this two-period rate of change, is there's nothing more simple out there than thinking of low to high or high to low, the trend for the day. And there's nothing more simple than looking at a downtrending market and finding the spots where it's had two low to high days and saying the next day is going to be a sell short day. So that's a very easy departure point for you right there. And then, of course, that's why we also want to model where are the periods or the signs that we could be entering an extended run, because that's where we immediately want to nip that rule in the bud and say, okay, we had 2 days high to low. Does that mean this day is going to be a buying day? No, we're going to filter out those rules because we are breaking from a range and making new lows on the two-period rate of change, etc., etc., etc. Okay, But as long as we can say, well, in this type of context of normal trading, that's a lovely little rhythm, 2 days low to high. And so on my nightly sheet, I'll simply say sell short day. I'm looking for the two period rate of change to flip down. And here's the way that we modeled this with Steve Moore of Moore Research Center. I simply said, what if I went short on the close of that first flip down on the two period rate of change? Will I be able to have a positive expectation if I, you know, play for $100 or half of an ATR or whatever it was the next day? So once I modeled it out that way, that, okay, if I shorted on the close here, would I be able to get some follow through the next day? Then obviously it's easy to beat the system. You don't have to wait for the close. You can trade with that power of the wind at your back that you're trending down off the opening price in these types of situations. So that's the way that I frame it out in my mind. And obviously you can only do that at selected spots and days. And that's why we're also going to look at the periods where we have the breakout mode and we really can't do that. So this is just an initial departure point. And remember what I told you, when we make these significant new lows on the two period rate of change like we did right there, that our modeling shows that the next day you could have gone short on Friday's close. You see that right there? You could have gone short, even though it seems scary because you're down so much, but you had a good push down this morning. And that's where it really pays to do your own research and do your own modeling. So yes, Taylor could buy in one of these situations. And what he says, if you read his words, is, you know, buy but for a scalp only, or buy but for a test of the previous day's lows. And we'll see several other ways that we can apply the same type of logic. So just to sum up, we're looking for the 2 to 3 days up or down. Of critical importance is our ability to watch how the market trades around the previous day's high or low. And those numbers are always imprinted in my brain for every market. They are the most important pivot points by what I'm going to be trading around. And then after that, it's opening price. So obviously today, that 1570 and a half handle was extremely important. But I also, that was Friday's low, okay? And then obviously Thursday's low came into play too, 1577. And then we also have the Globex highs and lows. So it was significant when we were finally able to break back up above that 1565. And you get it. Okay. Don't clutter your brain. All you're trying to do is think about what is the play for the day, the main trend for the day. Is it going to be a trend day? Are we just turning down, or has it been down multiple days? And, you know, we actually had two or three good swings that we could watch during the day. Very important for any trader that is following this type of technical or tape reading, and that is ignore all the news and the fundamentals. Ignore the distractions, ignore the noise, ignore the people yakking about their own opinions and so forth. You want to be concentrating on the price action and the pivots. The only times in my book that news comes into play is if there's a significant report out. How does the market act to that news? So, because that's going to tell you how sold out it is, or how overweighted it is to the long side. So this is straight from Taylor. He emphasized the importance of you doing your own work, of you seeing things for yourself. And in the long run, that's what is going to make you a consistent trader. You need to think about starting your own service for yourself. Write your own homework or your own analysis or your own newsletter just for yourself. You don't need to show it to friends. It's you are your own best client. And if you, I always show my work to other people and say, okay, here's what my game plan is for the next day, but I encourage them to make out their own game plan for the day, because they never know if I had a bad night's sleep or not. Okay, Let's move on. This is actually what my trade sheet looks like. So this is the way that I can keep fairly systematic in my approach, even though I am pretty much 100% discretionary trader, if you will. But this is just off of TradeStation, and I have a couple little patterns that I'm going to show you during the day here. This BO, this breakout, is a little three-bar coil triangle. This TP column is another indicator that indicates if we're poised for a trend day, and the readings below 45 signal that. I have this programmed in on the photon charts on the daily charts, if anybody was ever interested in seeing that. But you can see that coming in to this morning, we didn't really have any market with a low reading. I mean, sugar was quasi kind of low down there, but everything had pretty much made its move at the end of last week. So conversely, we didn't really have many markets that were a pure low to high or a high to low day today. We had some actual good two-way trading. Ignore this column for now. This P is where a flag pops up if there is a pinball buyer sell, a pattern I'll teach you, and this 5 if there is a 5 SMA buyer sell, which I will teach you. And then I simply flag if we made new momentum lows on that two-period rate of change, because that's such a powerful filter. So down to the brass tacks here, okay? Hopefully you'll all be able to go back and listen to that if I talked too quickly, but the main idea is all that counts. So several things I'm looking for when I'm, if we're in an uptrend, I'm cherry picking and I'm looking for those high to low, and then of course our two period rate of change highlights the buy day, and same thing, you can see several sequences of excellent buy days. I will actually look to take a sell short day if I can see some kind of momentum divergence on the two period rate of change. So if we had two low to high days and there's a little bit of momentum divergence, then I will play it. Otherwise, I'm very respectful of the trend. You can't quite see it down here on the chart, but probably one of the more powerful concepts that kept me out of trouble is respecting these three-bar triangles. Now, this was actually a pattern that was brought to my attention by somebody that gave me copies of the work of Richard Dennis. And Richard Dennis spoke about this three-bar triangle pattern when he was teaching his initial turtle class, and he was using the moves out of these three-bar triangles as add-on points, because one of the things that made his style of trading so powerful was that when he caught a winner, he added to it and leveraged it. And so he had certain add-on points, what he would call structural points, and one of them was these three-bar triangles. If we started making new 20-day highs after a three-bar triangle, he would add to the position again. So that's the way he used it. I just use it as being respectful of the fact that we can get a trend day out of these formations. And interestingly enough, on this particular chart, the market gave it everything it had to the upside on an upside breakout, and it couldn't do it. So that told us as well something about the state of the market, that it might already be a little bit overbought. Okay, so what I'm just showing you here are certain specific instances where on my sheet I'll use the Taylor concepts of buy day or sell short day to clue myself in as to what my bias is for the day. And then of course it may or may not work out, but when it does work out, the wins are so much greater. So you can see here, we've been in a downtrend. This is our 5-period SMA. Lovely little pattern recognition that we'll see with that. And up 1-2, low to high, and our sell short day setup. So that's pretty obvious. I'm sure you can start to get the basic idea until we form that 3-bar triangle pattern, you see? You get so that you can spot it with a with a lot of practice, and like I said, it's easily codable, you know, into my trade station. It can, you know, scan 50 markets or whatever and pop up if we've got these. Now, when we get the range expansion out of that, this is probably the highest pattern that we have leading to next day follow through. So if I had been so fortunate as to been long somewhere here thinking about those volatility breakout concepts, the volatility breakout system would probably have a buy stop to go long somewhere here, just some range expansion function. They're very counterintuitive if you are a trader who likes to have control, and people who trade like with market profile or short-term bar charts like to have control. So a volatility breakout system probably is not for you, but remind yourself of the concepts and the power of the statistics behind it. So once again, you could go home long, and Taylor would say hold it overnight looking for that next day follow through. All right, so you get the basic idea. Sometimes it's a little bit like reading tea leaves, and sometimes we find with the markets they're in this perfect rhythmic swinging mode, and then other times what happens is when we start to form these balance periods or these consolidation areas after a markup or a markdown, look what happened to our two-period rate of change here. So I find that if I start having an inside range day, see, for example, here's an inside range day, or even an NR7, which Toby Crabell made that popular, the narrowest range of the last 7 days, we found when I was doing that testing with Steve Moore that the directional indication by the two-period rate of change had no statistical significance. Okay, so for example, this could have flipped up right here and it would say, oh, go long right here, but you can see it was a narrow range bar, so this turn up had no statistical significance. Of more important was the three bar breakout coil that set up here that led to the downside breakout. So once again, you know, probably 60% of the time we have this lovely readable, very easy to read the tea leaves and get our bias for the day. And then there's two other types of conditions where we start to get that narrowing of range and consolidation, and oscillators are useless in a trading range, or the opposite extreme where we start to get these extended runs, which I really can't wait to show you, because it's just, I think, some of my better work over the last 7 or 8 years. Now, one last thing here, these bonds, I actually had a signal to short them here after you had their up 2 days, low to high, sell short day. And here's what happened, and this is actually a trade that that I did and had to redo. I did short the bonds, they tested, and they came right back up. So Taylor said, I love his rules because I've read that book so many times, it's like a brainwashing me. He says, you know, if you short but the market comes back up and looks like it's closing strong, exit your position and try again the next day. In other words, if it looks like the market's closing against you and you had the bias wrong at the end of the day, you don't want to take it home overnight, because the risk is that it can still trade higher. You can always get a chance to try again the next day. And so that's what happened here. Our sell short day really set up then the next day, and we went back in, and of course, I don't know about you guys, but usually when I cover, I find that half the time I have to resell at a lower price, but sometimes I get a chance to resell at a higher price too. It doesn't really matter, because what we're interested in is that the wins are so much bigger than the losses. Okay, so here, this is our extreme case, and this actually happens a lot more than people would care to think. Here's our three-bar coil that you should recognize by now, and you can see the two-period rate of change is a very useless tool. And then each arrow that I've got right here, you can see, points to where the next day would be a buy day, even though this day already traded low to high, you still had more follow-through. So it's just until we start to form resistance, and all of you know that support and resistance is two data points. So this is very powerful where we've got that slow line, remember, from that 310 oscillator and the fast line and all of these things going up together, and that is a condition that is in the market maybe 10% of the time. All right. And just one more example here. Now this is what happens when you have an extended run, and I'm really excited to show you the modeling on this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Here at this point we have 7 closes above that 5-period simple moving average, all right, which tells us that at that point it's statistically significant that there's a good chance of persistency of trend. And what that means is that only 50% of the time will we actually have continuation, and I'll show you the ways that we use to test that. But when it's right, the wins are so much bigger than the losers, and so that's where it's really important. When we enter this environment, this extended run environment, which happens in every market about 9 to 10 times a year, okay, when we enter this environment, I use this 5-period SMA as my support line, all right, and you can see the little dips back below this provide support or buying opportunities. And that's why you guys have to realize you have such an edge as a human that you can quantify the environments more readily and easily than a computer. Of course, a computer would know how many closes we've had on one side of 5 SMA, but when it comes to actually trading this stuff and putting all the rules together, I do think that humans have a significant edge. And then lastly, once again, once you start to form these little balance areas here. Now, Taylor, I don't think people necessarily read between the lines enough on Taylor, because they think that it's just about the 1 to 3 day cycle, you know, buy day, sell short day, which is just going to give us our bias for the day. But that's not true, because Taylor actually was a grain trader, and he traded with the seasonals. He was aware of the yearly cycles, and he also noticed that there were periods where you would want to be accumulating for a position or vice versa, and that's why he used his same approach to establishing positions, just looking to buy in a accumulation area, a basing area, after every high to low day. He would buy a little, and he wouldn't buy his whole line, but that was his way of building a little bit of a position. And then he said, once you break from one of these trading areas, and I just simply, there's no better way than drawing a little rectangle about it, once you break from one of these areas, let it run a couple days before looking for your sell short day, you see? So for example, you had an upside breakout here. You don't want to risk that you've got an extended run type of environment. You don't want to just immediately look to sell because you have two low to high days. Just respect the fact that it's a breakout and it can go a little bit further than we think. So all his rules make total sense when combined into a simple, very, very simple, get the basic idea right type of thing. So back to the S&Ps now. If we just put it all together, you've got your 3-bar triangle, 2-period rate of change is useless. This was a much broader rectangle that we broke out from. Remember, the breakouts from the daily chart formations are what can lead to the extended runs. When I know that we're in an extended run environment, I'm only going to look to trade from the long side. And I had to do this modeling for myself, guys, not only to take advantage and capture it, but also to keep myself from trying to pick tops in the market as well. I mean, we're all human, and we all want to think, oh, geez, it's gone too far. Maybe I'll short it and see if we can come back down to that level. And, of course, you never do, and it always goes further than you think it will. So it wasn't right until up here where we started to form some sell divergences on this 2-period rate of change, you see. So now it started to enter into that 2 days up, 2 days down, more swinging type of environment. Okay, I'll just show you lastly one more little bit of pattern recognition before we delve into some statistics. And then lastly, at the end of this, we are going to look at some of today's trading and go down to the intraday charts and talk about trade location. It's one thing to have this down conceptually, and it's always another thing to put theory into practice. And part of that comes with experience, of course. But until you do it on your own, it won't ever feel natural. You have to start, seeing it for yourself and thinking it for yourself, just the same as a market profile. I know for me, I was first introduced to market profile back in 1990, and it didn't make sense to me for a good 10 years. So maybe I'm just a slow learner, everybody has their own pace, right? Okay, so lastly, the little bit of work, I did combination with the 310 oscillator here, and I found that it was always a really nice little middle part of the swings up or down. So these were where some of the original little buy antes came into play. And you can see just picking off one or two choice trades once a week, in two or three different markets, it's sometimes it's easier than it looks, and sometimes it's harder when it looks. And where it's harder is where you start to have these markets that just are grinding and there's no real volatility. So if you're a trader, you need volatility. Okay, we need volatility because it creates uncertainty. So for me, this has always been a nice methodology that I could go to where the action was. You know, if the yen all of a sudden was coming to life, you could go and trade the yen. You know, if gold was dying because it just had this incredibly big move and was getting very choppy and noisy, you know, you didn't have to trade that. You could find another vehicle. So those are some of the things that worked for me. Everybody again has their different approaches. Now, when you study anything and when you look at this stuff, it's equally important, I wanted to point this out, to see the times that it doesn't work, you know, because our modeling, and I can talk about modeling and systems and stuff, and yeah, it could work 80% of the time, but what about that 20% of the time that it doesn't work? What would you look for, and what would that mean? So I love this little example here, and this was actually a trade that we did. We had this little three-bar triangle pattern here, okay, and this oscillator wasn't showing anything threatening or ominous. It just looked like we could still be in a trading range and go back down and test the lower end of the range, which we actually did. But here was a case where we had a downside breakout of this three-bar triangle. We actually came back up off our lows, but even if you had held this trade overnight, the mere fact that we gapped up so much the next day and took out the high of this showed that this was like a failed breakout to the downside. And there's nothing more powerful in technical analysis, whether you're looking at chart formations that are longer duration or little small patterns. There's nothing more powerful than a case where the market gives it everything it had to the downside to try and flush people out, and then that was it. Okay, so then gold proceeded to continue to march merrily higher for the next 2 years, and of course you had another chance here. Perhaps you got a little bit of your money back. All right, so sometimes the market's choppy and it just doesn't give much, and other times, like right now, the volatility is exceptional. When I was on the floor, there was a great expression that one of the specialists had, and he said, you have to take the cookies when they pass the plate around. So hopefully this volatility will persist for at least another 2 to 3 weeks here. This is the cookie time. Just a couple more examples. I don't want to belabor this. Here was a case where, you know, we've got a really dweeby, choppy environment. We haven't broken out yet. We're at the middle of an equilibrium level. Volatility is super low. This was a trade that I put this in there because I did it. It was a buy day. We went down and we rallied up, but then we came back down. And sometimes these things are aggravating. But the thing is that when you hit one right, you know, always remember that in your trading. Maybe 20 to 25% of these things can be huge wins, and that's really what we're playing for. The rest of the time, it's just another trade, pass it under the table. It's very similar to playing cards or poker. You know, you're not dealt a fat hand all the time, but when you are, you know it, and, you know, milk that when you do get one. So one last trick I wanted to show you here was I like to use the slow line on the 310 oscillator. Remember, that was my moving average oscillator in the very beginning, and I like to trade the flips against that. So I'll use this as my trend in momentum. So right here on this bean chart, I have a downtrend in the momentum, and I'll be a little bit more aggressive when I get the cases where this two-period rate of change, this is our two-period rate of change, is rallies back up and is poised to flip down, and that's where I actually came up with the original anti little terminology. I don't know why it was like anti it up here, but you can see a correct down 1-2, and the actual trend in momentum was a positive, and so it led to a nice choice little buy scalp. So that's something that you can play around and look with for yourself, see if it does anything for you. Some of my biggest wins have come when this slow line has just turned down and I get that first sell short day flip on the two period rate of change. Okay, those have been probably some of my biggest 2 to 3 day trades, you know, over my trading history. And you'll see this in the S&Ps as well. So here would be the opposite case where this slow line just turned up, and here we go, boom, buy day. You know, I know that my model says to be long by the close, that I could enter on the close to initiate a position, and so therefore all you have to do is look how it trades off the opening price or short-term continuation patterns. You know, that's where I think if you're good at reading the 5, the 15, the 30, the 120 minute charts, etc., it just gives you that much more confidence, and that's how we're actually going to finish up this session. So I hope I'm giving you lots of ideas here for studying yourself, and you'll see that there's numerous spots where the market just flattens out and it's not of much value, and then we just stay perched on the sidelines in breakout mode, either waiting for that range expansion to kick in or waiting for a penetration of these previous support or resistance areas. One last pattern here. I know I've said that several times, and this does not happen as much as it used to, although you can see it on the S&Ps recently in several cases. But I have what I called my five-finger trade, and that was looking for this two-period rate of change sell divergence, and it would usually be a count of 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and it would form a little divergence. And believe it or not, you can see this beautifully on a 240-minute chart as well in the S&Ps, and that often was a trade that I could put on for several days in a row. And so being aware of that would keep me from thinking that the S&Ps right now have anywhere near a bottom, because we just made that new momentum lows on the close on Thursday. So that tells me at least I've got Friday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday before I would even think about possibly having a two-period rate of change buy divergence where I would feel comfortable carrying a trade long home overnight. So I hope that all makes sense. Some of the modeling now that we're going to do from a quantitative standpoint, there was a pattern that I put in the Street Smarts book called Pinball, and one thing that we did not have tested at the time, so if you test the original Pinball pattern in the Street Smarts book, it's not so compelling. But if you simply take the pinball sells, okay, where the price is below the 20-period EMA, or the pinball buys where the price is above the 20-period EMA, you'll see that you get much better statistics, and I'll show you the actual numbers on those statistics. And then lastly, I really want to keep on emphasizing that Taylor said, respect the market when it's running out of these ranges, and don't try and top fish it, you know, so forth. You know, you'll do more harm to your account trying to be a hero in these cases and pick that one bar that does happen to blow off, I'll show you a couple things that you can watch instead. So quickly here, let's move on and get down to some hardcore brass tacks, this persistency of trend and 5SMA work. I just really has made an impact in my trading, modeling these outliers and then taking that one step beyond and saying, what are the conditions that precede this persistency of trend? In other words, how do these things start out? Can we start to categorize them into a few patterns? Obviously, a breakout from a daily chart formation, such as a wedge, can lead to a stronger degree of trendiness, okay? But if you're really bored on a weekend, you know, I'm just making a joke here, you know, you're probably catching your breath on the weekend like I am. But here's what they look like. This is a simple five-period moving average of a daily candlestick chart, no big deal. And you can see that right here, we started to have our extended run, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven closes below one side of the 5 SMA. So at this point in my mind, I keep on telling myself, short the first close back above the 5 SMA. That's what I'll put on my daily trade sheet, short the first close back above, so I don't get too caught into thinking, oh, this is a buy day because we've just had multiple days down from high to low. You can see what a trap that would be. This is a buy day. You don't want to think that way. You want to be thinking, I want to short that first close above the 5 SMA, and it's going to keep you from getting into trouble. A different type of trend following model. There's other types of models that will keep you positioned in this, okay? But we're not talking about those right now. We're talking about the Taylor 1 to 2 day, 3 day overnight type of trades. So our model shows if you get that first close back above, I'll say this, the model will go short, okay? Maybe you are not shorting on the close, but you know that you've got a downside bias to trade back below and close back below that 5 SMA, and I'm going to show you the statistics on this because they're really powerful. They will make you respect this trade. Now, as always, everybody has a different temperament, and I understand some people are day traders as well, and you're not going to be holding a trade for 2 to 3 days, but at least you have a little roadmap that you've got a good confidence factor that we can go and retest back down that low. So here would be where the system went short and the system covered, and chalk one up for the system. So just a couple others, and then I'll show you the statistics behind this. We've been in the extended run to the downside. This is crude, okay? First close back above, the computer goes short, and it covers there. And here was a case where the computer actually went short right here because we had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 closes below, okay? So now the computer's shorting there, and this would have been a very, very uncomfortable trade for the computer. It looks like it actually had a loss. So there's a loss there. And here's another one as well where the computer went short, okay, and by the time the computer covered, it was also a loss. Okay, I'm showing you all the losers for a reason, okay? I want you to see the statistics even in light of these losers. And then, of course, you remember what I said, that when you have these three-bar coils here, all right, when you have these three-bar coils, you actually want to be in the direction of this. So when I do my modeling, when I do my basic testing, I do it stripped out of any of these filters first, because if I have a model which I can then actually improve on a little bit, I'll feel that much better. See, we actually had this three-bar balance here as well, so I'm not surprised that we got a little bit better trendiness there in that direction. Same thing here. Well, this is actually a different thing that I'm going to show you. I'll come back to this trade. This is where we enter on the close of day 7 on these extended runs. Okay, I'll I'll come back to this in a minute. I just want to show you the stats here for this pinball. I'll show you a couple more here where you have the extended run to the upside. Okay, the computer goes long, the computer exits. I think you get the idea right now. Even at the very top here, it would have kept you from picking this top in wheat. Here was your first close below. Here was your first close back above. A very skinny scalp, but on balance, here's a basket over 10 years of these basic markets. And this is if you exited on day one, day two, day three, for the little classic pinball. Okay, this isn't the 5SMA trade, but same type of concept. I wanted to, this is a little bit out of order. I wanted to show you that there is good statistics behind these, and even in spite of the losers that I'm showing you, which I would be doing you a disservice if I didn't show you the losing trades, there's very compelling statistics behind this data that I'm showing you here. So let's go back, and I want to show you another trade that is really going to keep you respecting these 5 SMAs. And yes, just so you know, we have traded this on a mechanical basis. I find that when we do a program of mechanical systems, for me, it's actually a lot of work because we have to have somebody overnight watching the trades and making sure that they get executed properly, and it ends up being a little bit of an operation, not quite my normal style, but we have done it in the past periodically and with very successful results. It just is something that we're not doing right now, but this was one of the systems, and that is entering in the direction of the this extended run on the close of day 7. And then we tested out what if you exited day 8, day 9, day 10, day 11, day 12. You see? You get it? So it seems pretty unnatural to want to short natural gas at this point right here. We've already sold off. We'd already broken down. But here would be a case where you actually, the computer shorted on here, and it covered 7 days later right here. And another case here where the computer actually went long on the close of, I think this was 6 days we were doing long, and exited 6 days later. So what makes a really powerful concept, what makes something really durable and robust, is when it holds up over a broad variety of variables and parameters. So it doesn't matter if you went long on day 8 and exited day 8, etc. It's just the fact that this is, people have no idea how powerful these trends really are. So whoops, let me get back here. So you get the idea here. Here was the Dow Mini Futures. How many of you would feel comfortable putting on a position short right at that point in the Dow? There's no way that you would feel comfortable doing that unless you had very compelling statistics to tell you that if you did this 100 times, you would come out that much more wealthy. Okay, so this is the 5SMA trade. Whoops, I'm going backwards. That's why that's out of sequence. I apologize. Okay, so here's just two more charts of spots where you would have initiated on the 7th day of these extended runs. All right. Now, as an aside, when we did this modeling, we did not use stops. Okay, so I'm just showing you the tendency. The reason that we didn't use stops is anytime you add stops, it will deteriorate your work. But more importantly, is what we did when we traded this type of approach is we also traded a volatility breakout system against it. So for example, if you were long for whatever reason here on the Russell, because it was day 7 of this 5 SMA thing, and we actually got 8, 9, 10, all right, the volatility breakout system would have gone short there. So we used that volatility breakout system against it, and it worked out pretty nicely. So just the system stuff, it tends to be a whole different environment. But I hope that I have made my point clear that if you're going to be approaching the markets looking for counter trend trades, or shorting after 2 days up or buying after 2 days down type of rhythm, we need to see the cases where it's very important not to do that and to switch gears and say, now how would Taylor have traded the last 3 days, for example, in the bonds? You know, how would Taylor have traded the last couple days in the Australian dollar or so forth? And I'm going to show you some things that will show you how his concepts are still very powerful and work. Now, this here is the days after entry that our trade was exited. So this was if we had bought on the seventh day of that 5 SMA type of thing on our basket of markets, and we exited 5 days later, 7 days later, 9 days later, 10 days later, okay? What I want to you to catch your eye, okay, really, just really important, is that when, and this is very basic, but when you have a trend, the longer you hold it, the longer you press it, the bigger the profits. And this is pretty evident in this data here. These were different markets here on the side. I'm sorry, I cut off the margin. It shouldn't really matter because you can see there's a significant expectation in all of them. But the longer that you hold the trade in general, the bigger the wins. So the wins can be huge. The losses can hurt, but they're never as big as the wins. And just respect that when you get into these extreme trendy environments. With every rule, there is an exception. Okay, that sounds like typical trader speak, right? With every rule, there's an exception. So here we've got a case where I just want to point out that there is a limit to this, okay? And the limits we've found is that once you start to hit this 18 closes or 20 closes on one side of the 5 SMA, do not look to short the first close back above. It just was too climatic, too extreme, and in fact, we can actually make a trade where we go long and exit 2 days later. So here's another case here on the Russell, and this was the statistics there. They're not overwhelming, but they do show you, this is very robust modeling that holds up still today. So lots of little secret tricks we can do with a two-period rate of change, with a pinball, with a 5 SMA that says, yes, there is a statistically significant approach to this. So now all that jargon aside, let's get rid of the theory, let's get rid of the modeling and the systems, and let's just look at some real-world applications, okay? I know that many of my audience are familiar with market profile concepts, and it's been something that's just totally been brought to light more in the last 10 years. And I love Jim Dalton's very first book that he wrote that really emphasizes the price action off the opening. And that's where we can see, is it going to be an open drive? Okay, these are just very simple concepts that are powerful. Or is it going to be an open test reject type of thing? Or auction, rotate around the opening price. And these are the same concepts that we can use with Taylor. And Taylor's ideal scenario would be where we've been down 2 days high to low, or even down 1 day high to low in an uptrending market, and we open and we have that morning test of the previous day's low, and that is your buying spot. That happens a lot more than you think. Of course, in this environment, the volatility is so much greater, but we're in a momentum type of environment right now. But in general, the market always tests the previous day's high or low about 96% of the time. I got to correct that. That's the pit session low, because we can have more inside range days than that. The pit session, the previous day's pit session. But let's just look at a couple things now with real world application, okay? Because the market profile types of concepts are so similar to Taylor. And the first is that volume is a very significant component. As you know, is that higher time frame player around? and that higher time frame player, the institutionals, are the ones that create the money flows, and that's who we really want to ride their coattails once the market's trending. So if volume's light, you're much more likely to get one of those Taylor days that's not going to close on its highs or its lows. It could be more of a market profile, auction type of day, and so forth. Okay, so I put up some examples of today because I thought that it would be fun just to see how some real life situations unfolded, and then some of the tools we can use to work on better trade location. Obviously, the two most important pivots for Taylor were this previous day's low and this previous day's high, and so forth. And in this type of environment, you can see, look at this, see already the three-bar coil that we had that breakout from. These three-bar coils are very important. So we had our trend day down, and the next day, if I was coming in, I could easily say a Taylor buy day, but I'd say buy day scalp only because of this new lows on the two-period rate of change. So if I came in and I had 2 days high to low, and I'm just doing this generically, and I said, okay, I'm looking for a buy day. I want to buy a test of the previous day's low the next day. What really happened here? What happened is that we made our highs first. So instead, the market rallied up, and you can see it was right at this point. We opened here in our day session, and we made our highs first, and then we sold off. So already I've shown you that the labels that we give today to each day are a little bit arbitrary, and that it doesn't mean that you can't short on a buy day or you can't buy on a sell short day. It's just as giving you your first initial bias when you're doing your homework at night. Now, what I like to do is after these big range days, I call them Z days. So on my sheet, I would actually put a Z day, which is a consolidation day, which means that if we had sold off and flushed below this low first in the morning, I would look to be a buyer, and I would look to trade back up to that opening, to that previous day's low. And that's exactly, if you read Taylor and you see, that's what he says, is when we have a deep penetration for a buy day, your objective level is just the previous day's low. So he's not looking to hold this home overnight. He would be looking to sell it back out as you come up to that low. So if you read between his lines and really understand what he's saying, it is just so basic and so practical in terms of a trader's library. And for me, I just keep on brainwashing myself over and over, so it becomes fairly automatic, which sometimes depends on how much sleep I had the night before. It's less automatic if I haven't had much sleep. So here we had 2 days. Now we have one more big down day, and interestingly, coming in this morning, this was the one of the very few markets that I had a buy day on, meaning the chance for a fresh flip up on this two-period rate of change. You see, everything else on Friday had flipped up and was in a position of the pinball cells or where it could flip back down. So on here on the right-hand side of the chart, I just wanted to show you, no oscillators, no nothing. I've got the high for the day and the low for the day marked off. All right, this trade station's a little dweeby in that, like, this is the Sunday evening session. But you can see we opened here. This is Taylor's ideal scenario. We opened and we tested this previous day's low. Open test, he's got his buy day play, and then started to rally for the day. So this would be a case where you possibly have the chance of lows made first, unlike here where you opened and you rallied first. Unfortunately, for highs made first in a downtrending market is more of a short sale. And this is where you can have a little bit of, I think, edge in terms of your tape reading and your and these things that the Taylor didn't have is almost every market this morning formed these 120 and 240 minute buy divergences, and crude just happened to be one of the more powerful ones. So that might tell you, am I going to get a little off of this trade, or am I going to get a lot? Now, I mean, crude still has this little downtrending channel, but there's lots of tricks that you can do once you're in a trade to say, how do I want to manage this? Do I want to hold it to the close? Do I want to exit it when it comes back up above that previous low? Or is there a chance that there's a little bit more here on the board? The S&Ps, I'm going to show you two interesting things. I'm going to show you the S&Ps with the 24-hour data, and then I'm going to show you the S&Ps with the pit session data. I mean, because, you know, we're sleeping overnight, you have to say, well, gee, what if I wasn't able to trade at night? You know, did I miss the move? And, you know, how do we cope with that? And then I just want to quickly show you to end a little bit of time of day work, so that you understand how, even if you come in the next day and there's a huge gap, it shouldn't change your approach to the markets within a Taylor framework of looking at the test of the low or the test of the high. Can we rally back up to the previous day's low? Is it a sell short day, low made first? In other words, the move already happened overnight, okay? So you get that? It's a sell short day, low made first, meaning that maybe we were looking to short it on the when we did our evening analysis, but golly, you know, we come in and Europe got bonkered, and the S&Ps are gapping down. You know, what if it's a sell short day, but we make our lows first, and there's actually a chance to play for the long side? So blue line is our opening price, and obviously you can see the opening price is always that evening opening session, and you had this technically, by the way, here on our computer model and on my trade sheet was a three-bar breakout. Okay, so you see this three-bar breakout coil, three-bar triangle. That's where the high is lower than the two-day high, and the low is higher than the two-day low, and it forms these wicked little formations where you can get these big trend moves out of them. So so coming in to today, we'd already had, I knew that we had this short on the close because it was up one day in a downtrending market on this. That's what the model said. And then here was our morning flush down. There was still a chance, even there was the evening session, okay, so the evening session, you can see we opened up there and sold off from last night. There still was an opportunity on the pit session to trade the short side. You can see where we reopened up here, and there was still a downward bias to the day. Let's go down to the intraday charts, though, and you can see that we still have those same type of rhythm that every market did with the 240-minute buy divergences. So it might help us get our initial bearing thinking sell short day. It's not one of those classic ones, though, where we had the two-period rate of change poised to flip, and you actually, Taylor's could have even said, okay, if I had a buy day, buy a test or a penetration of the previous day's low, how would he have traded that? He would wait, of course, until he found some type of short-term support, which we did on those S&Ps, and you at least had some roadmap that said you could have a correction or a reaction back up, even though we're still in these downtrending channels. So what I really wanted to do was show you the difference between the 24-hour session and the day session, because I've fronted off charts and done the analysis with the two-period rate of change on just these day sessions only, and you'd be surprised, the statistics still hold up equally well with the two-period rate of change, you know, looking for that flip for the buy day if you entered on the close or you know, et cetera, et cetera. So here you can see the big gap down, and obviously some of your market profile concepts came into play here, the gap and the trend type of thing. But I wanted to compare this to the 24-hour data. You know, you'll still have the same chart formations, the same intraday buy divergences on the a little bit lower time frame that you would on the 24-hour data. Now, the reason I'm showing a 120-minute chart is because for the pinball buys and sells and these two-period rate of change flips that are so powerful, you will see that the 120-minute swings are even a 240-minute near this almost identically. You can overlay a two-period rate of change on a daily chart with 240-minute intraday data, and you'll see the swings are almost identical. I'll show you a little case here. I wanted to show a copper market because recently you could see that it had Taylor's break from that range in which he says let it run, you know, 3 days, 3 to 5 days before looking for the buy day. In other words, don't think of this as the buy day after 2 days down. Don't think of this as the buy day after 2 days down. Let it run that extra little cycle here. So this was kind of interesting, and I wanted to show you this because it was an example of a pinball sell on the close on Friday. And you can see in the downtrend, you had 1 day low to high, and this was actually where we closed. These bars are a little misleading. I don't like the way that TradeStation marks the closes of their bar arbitrarily when it should have been marked a little bit higher. Sometimes they do it with the old pit session close. But anyway, here's where we closed. And definitely there would have been no reason to carry a long home overnight with this setup. In fact, like I told you, our systems would actually short on the reopening of that evening session there. But let's just look at, I want you to see how this pinball sell looks on the intraday 120 and 240 minute. So you see, this is what you're really trading with this. You know, Taylor's just giving you the basic little concept of thinking low to high or high to low, but what we're really looking for is, with the choice setups, the bear and bull flags on the 120, 240 minute. That is your 5 SMA trade. That is your pinball buyer sell, and you can see too the coils that form. When we have those little three-bar coils, they will always show up as converging trend lines, not always, but enough of the time on these 120, 240 minute time frames. And if you are able to keep this as your primary roadmap, I think it will help you greatly stay out of the noise and get caught in the cross currents that Taylor refers to, because sometimes you can see a little buy scalp in the S&Ps, maybe on a tick buy divergence, and that's all and well, but you might really be trading the trees instead of the forest, and the forest is where you have your cleanest roadmap and where you really want to be trading that trend for the day instead of being cute, you see? So here, if you look at these types of structures, you get a much better feel of that trend for the day. And then lastly, I just wanted to show you one more. Hold on. Try rebooting the server. One more. This was one of the few pinball buys that we had coming in today. These were the August hogs, and here was our pullback, our one high to low day, all right, our one high to low day, and this is the 30-minute chart. You could buy off the opening price, and we actually got a retest back up pretty quickly, so I don't think that this is going to be a killer trade, but it was one of the few where I had a buy on the two-period rate of change, et cetera, et cetera. And just lastly, here's what it looked like on the 120-minute charts. So that's what you're trading. I don't want to take any more time because I want to have plenty of time for questions. But before that, I want to show you just some time-of-day work to show you how important this opening price concept is and how it can be applied to different time zones. So what we did is we were trying to model when the highs for the day and when the lows for the day were made. And you'll see how important this was today even. And almost each of these could be treated as a separate day. So what we found is that very often the highs and the lows for the day happened around right here, Asia opening. Okay, Asia opening, Europe opening. Okay, I use 7 a.m. Central Time for the start of the U.S. session. Why? Because this was very close to when the bonds used to open, and this is when all the New York traders sit down at the institutional desks, 8 a.m., and that's why so many times we see gold used to move off this 7 a.m. reading. Very often the highs or lows for the morning session come at 7 a.m. And then lastly, check this out. How many times we see our highs or lows for the afternoon come right at that 12 noon. Now think about today, okay? Think about today, and we had pretty much, if you had taken a 12 o'clock reading, 12 o'clock Central Time, that would have been the low for the afternoon session in the E-minis. So you could almost think of these, each of these, as a separate day. Now I'll tell you one more interesting piece of data, and here's the lows for the day. One more interesting piece of data. It is very rare that you get three sessions back-to-back. It's extremely rare that you get four sessions back-to-back. So if you thought of each one of these as a separate day, you'll see that you can trend in Europe, trend in the U.S. morning session, and then the party stops when Europe closes. Or we can trend in the afternoon session on like we did in the breakdown for the Fed meeting, trend in Asia, but then do rotation in the European session. Here's the S&Ps. You can see if I just break out the S&Ps, this is the start of the evening session here, the reopening, and very often that is the high or the low for that session. So that's why if you come in and you think about the 7 a.m. reading with Taylor and then testing that overnight low, you can apply the same approach, you know, using the Globex lows. I still prefer to use the previous day's higher low and so forth. But that's just a last parting shot there. So with that, I know that I covered a lot of material, and I was really trying to present a lot of concepts for you. And let's see here. I just have to find out now where the question box is.
Hey, Linda. I can read the questions to you. So if anybody has questions, now's the time to go ahead and start typing those out. And Linda, I just want to make sure you can hear me.
Okay, so I believe
I don't
that
think so.
I've got plenty of time for questions and answers, and I'm going to let Mike handle this.
Yeah, can you hear me, Linda? Linda, can you hear me? Hang on one second, guys. Yeah, I can read the questions to you if you can just turn your speakers back on. Okay, can you hear me now? Okay, how about now, Linda? Okay, so I'm going to hang up the phone and we'll go back to the... Okay, thanks. Okay, guys, so let me take a look at the questions. So first, I want to thank Linda, as always. Excellent presentation. There's a couple of comments here that I thought were worth reading. Benjamin says, is there a Linda Raschke energy bar available, please? And... Gary asks, makes a comment, Linda is a trading cyborg sent back from the future to train humans in market analysis. Let's see, let me look for questions here. And Linda, I don't know if your mic is on because I'm not hearing you.
Actually, you know what?
There we go.
Excuse me. I can actually see the questions here now. So if you want, I can just read them and handle this. So first of all, the first question is, hopefully I answered it in the talk. When I look for yesterday's high and low, am I looking at the day session or the 24-hour period? And the reason is I always look at the 24-hour for several reasons. Number one, that's what the computer looks at. When we do our modeling and we're saying what is the percent of time that we trade above the previous day's high, that's always 24-hour data. Number two, a lot of charting programs out there don't really have the ability to break it out in the same way that TradeStation does. For example, TradeStation, you can have ES.D and only see the pit session data. CQG, you can do the same thing as well, but it takes a lot of extra configuring and fumbling around. So I'm just assuming that I want to see the levels that the most market participants see, and that means, you know, people in Europe, people overseas, the big fund managers. So I'm always using the 24-hour data for that. There's another question for foreigners. What is a pinball? And a pinball is simply a little way of, it's actually a three-period RSI, three-period RSI of a one-period rate of change. And it was just a goofy little thing that we published in the Street Smarts book of a way of quantifying when you had a reaction in a very strong trending market. So pinballs are going to be most significant as showing us that, hey, there's a little reaction up here in a very strongly trending market, because otherwise it's just not so many ways to have a concrete signal to get into those. How to spot the three-day triangle pattern? That's pretty easy. I want a high that's lower than the two-day high and a low that's higher than the two-day low. So you have a little three-bar coil there, and you know, a lot of times on the 120-minute intraday data, you could have a low ADX. Now, here's the catch. It's nice that we can actually flag these, but what's even more important is just think about having three bars of overlap. Sometimes you actually get not a perfect little three-bar triangle, but I know that people that look at market profile like to call these three-bar balance areas, and a lot of times the moves out can be very trendy. So it's the basic concept there. What do I think of order flow? I'm not sure what that means. I hope you're not trying to think about reading the matrix or the book, okay? For me, order flow, I call it money flows. I'm just simply looking at the volume. I want to see, do we have broad volume moving across all the markets? So obviously today, when we put those lows in, you have that same buy divergence on the crude, the bonds, the S&Ps. The money flows were sloshing out of the market, and the money flows were sloshing back into that market. That was very, very strong money flows. Now, in terms of order flow, if you're talking about doing something like quantifying the volume that trades on the bid or quantifying the volume that trades on the offer, there are several indicators that do this. In our work, we found out that 95% of the time, it's just basically correlated with a momentum divergence on any oscillator. And think about it, on the first flush down, everybody's like, get out the door, and it's hit the bid, hit the bid, hit the bid. Now, once the low has been established and you have a reaction up, think about it. Everybody knows that there's buyers that came in at that previous low. So when you go back down for your retest, of course you're not going to have that same heavy order flow, hit the bid, hit the bid, hit the bid, because now we know there's a well-defined low, and you'll actually start to get some buying or even short covering coming in on those. So I think that you can just see the same thing on a little basic momentum divergence, and you'll also see volume divergences and stuff like that. So I don't try to read the order flow. I'll just try to read the price action on a very basic level, last trade. Do the Taylor and the 5-period SMA methods also work on a 1-minute chart, or tick charts. I don't use a two-period rate of change on any of my intraday data. It's just too noisy for me, but I bet you you could see some cool things on the hourly charts if you wanted to explore that. You know, hopefully there's just lots of ideas here that you can explore. The five-period SMA is a really nice, sweet little indicator or guideline in a super strong trending market. Yes, it does work on 1 minute charts or tick charts, you know, in terms of, you know, your pops above that might be your only shorting opportunities that you get. You know, just make sure that you're not approaching an area where you do have buy divergences forming or so forth. So let's see here. Side 14, the breakout of the triangle afterwards, would you have traded a buying day highs made first short setup? And I have to smile at this because that's exactly what it's like trying to read this Taylor book, buy day highs made first short sale. It sounds like a mouthful, and I'm not sure if this was the only vernacular that this poor man had, but I still find it effective. Yes, there's room to trade on either side with that crude, you know, where we had the rally back up in the morning session. I think one of the most important things, today is of course an exception, but the Taylor made a point of saying is that the morning tests are the strongest trades. Fading a morning move is such a stronger trade than fading an afternoon move because the markets can be trendier in the afternoon. So that's a tough play looking for a buy day high made first if that high is coming later in the day. All right. In one of your results tables, coffee showed as a loss over every single test period. You know what? That's one thing about modeling, and that's what tells you that it's good modeling, is that it's not optimized, and it could just be that the coffee market was a very noisy market for that pattern, and honestly, over all our years of modeling, I've seen things be just noisy and dweeby, as I call them, for 5 or 6 years, and then all of a sudden it'll come to life and be a fabulous trading market, and then sometimes some of the most fabulous trading markets that were the greatest statistics, natural gas used to be one of them, all of a sudden changed their character a little bit. And now the natural gas is coming back to life again as perfectly killing them on the models. So I think everything cycles, but you want to see, 85% of them have a positive expectation, and then you're on to something. And coffee is one of those markets that has definitely had super hot streaks for trend following systems and then super losing thrash whipsaws for trend following systems. So somebody asked, I mentioned a coil, and I'm not familiar with this term. A coil is just simply where I refer to a lot of price bar overlap, and you can put the converging trend lines up on a 120 minute type of time frame. This copper coil here, just think about it fluctuating around a central value area, and that's another little market profile concept. How is the gap down resulted from overnight session play in your daily entries? And gaps are great because there's all kinds of pattern recognition and testing you can do with that. First of all, is it a gap below the previous day's low? Once you do gap, you can start framing out what is that first 20-minute bar or what is that first 30-minute bar. Usually if you have a big gap and you take out the high of that first 20 or 30-minute bar or the low of that first 20 or 30-minute bar, you'll have some follow-through. So what I like to do is where we have these big gaps in the pit session, honestly, I use the DAX. I use the DAX 60, 120, 15-minute charts because it provides a little bit more of a continuous roadmap. And interestingly, today when the S&Ps were pushing down, that DAX was not making lower lows. It was not breaking. So I like the intraday charts on that, and I like the intraday tick charts. It'll still give you a good continuous feel for do we still have continuation patterns or not. You want something, with this Taylor stuff, for me, It's like, just give me an initial bias. Give me something to look for. A lot of days it just, you know, it doesn't really pan out to anything. And but it does keep you looking at the previous day's high or low. It's a great guideline if you just trade the S&Ps and you just trade the index futures. I mean, that's what I only traded the index futures with it, and I traded them every day off of Taylor. And for me, it was just, it kept me over-trading. It kept me from over-trading, and it kept me from, you know, with a nice bias on the days that were working. It was really a great tool for, you know, when you had a winner, to stay with it a little bit. And then, of course, you know, there's always light volume rotation days that do nothing. Okay, what is the best way you have ever found to determine if today will be a range day or a trend day? Well, I can answer that sarcastically and say the best way to determine if it's going to be a trend day is if I come in on the wrong side of the market. You know, it's probably going to be a trend day against me. You know, there is no perfect way, but my best tool that I use is I look at the NYSE volume. I look at the NYSE volume for the first 30 minutes and see, overall, is the volume higher than the day before, or is the volume lower than the day before? So that's a good enough proxy, okay, if there is good institutional activity. And obviously the exceptions to that might be if everybody's waiting for FOMC reports or something like that. My mechanical system was quite successful, but why are you not doing that anymore? Well, I trade around it quite a lot, and it wasn't just one mechanical system. We had a portfolio of about 10 of these, you know, or actually more, I think we had 14 of them running on 20 different markets with give-ups to three FCMs, and it was executing off TradeStation, and but none of the counts were clearing there. And it was an awful lot of work. It was just a ridiculous amount of work, and it wasn't becoming fun because it was just so much to manage and oversee. I suppose that you know, I could just walk away from the game and, you know, set a little team up of people just to grind this out. But I love the modeling, and I love the sport of it, and I really like trading. And it's like so for me, you know. We run it on and off, and there's periods where I go back to, you know, doing a volatility breakout system mechanically or something. And the other problem that we were running up against on some of these patterns, the volatility breakout, is that, you know, we had $140 million, and we were just getting way too much slippage on some of the entries. In other words, you know, on some of the stops and the you know, the breakouts, you're limited as to how much size you can do in markets like coffee or nat gas or stuff. So, you know, there's pros and cons to all different styles. That's, you know, okay. What is a pinball in real life? A pinball machine, you know, Tommy the Who, you know, I guess everybody has little video games now. Nobody knows what a real good pinball machine is, but yeah, that's one thing I've always wanted, my own little library of or my own little collection of pinball machines. You know, I get all the ones that we used to play in college. Okay, how do you navigate through the many strategies you use and decide which strategy is suitable to apply to a specific trade? That's where it's helpful just to think of, is one of these indicators or these patterns going to help give you guidance as to the trend for the day? Seriously, if you could do just fine analyzing or looking at a 120-240 minute chart at night and looking at the swings on that at night, you know, you can connect them and do the pattern recognition on that. You know, it's just that when I first started out reading Taylor and modeling this stuff, you know, we just didn't have that many sophisticated tools. You know, I didn't even have a trade station or anything. It was pretty primitive back in those days, and that's why it did work. You know, I could keep some stuff by hand, and it just kept me focusing on the important things. You know, if we were trading high to low, or looking for the little reversal in the swing. You know, so if I reduced it down to a very simple concept of looking for the reversal in the swing every 2 to 3 days. You know, one 2 to 3 days you're looking to trade from the short side, and the next 2 to 3 days you're looking to trade from the long side, and you have to use that as a departure point and then say, well, where are all the points that it's not so wise to take that approach? And I think that you could do the same with any method. You know, if you're looking at market profile, you're definitely going to put it in a context of, are we in a trending or markup period, or have we entered a bracketing environment where it's a trading range, and it's going to behave differently in those types of things. Just again, the slow line on the two-period rate of change indicator that you saw on that slide way back was the 310 oscillator. I'm just going to put this first slide up. I don't even know if I'm still on here or not. But you can see the slow line is a 16-period moving average of the difference of the 3 and 10-period simple moving average. I did not come up with this. It's just what was used by the security market research charts that I originally started trading with. And it just took me a long time for my eyes to kind of figure out the pattern recognition here. And it's just something that I've gotten used to. Oscillators are not a perfect science. There's a lot of noise in them. They don't test out mechanically, but that slow line is very smooth. It's a lagging indicator. In other words, the market's going to turn before it does, but I love looking for the sell divergences on the 310 oscillator when that slow line is poised to flip down or vice versa. The bands that I use on my chart are actually Keltner channels. Somebody was asking if they were Bollinger bands or Keltner channels. Keltner channels are just simply an average true range function. And for my purposes, I just found out that they test out a lot better. They model out better than Bollinger bands, which are standard deviation functions. But you can still get an edge using those as well. Do I have a favorite thread on Big Mike's trading forum? I have to confess, I bet you there's good material on all the threads. You know, my nose is usually buried, you know, in my numbers and doing my own chart analysis than reading other people's thoughts. But, you know, I bet there's lots of sources of good ideas and inspiration on those other threads. So I think it's a very valuable thing to have such a public forum with so many threads and ideas bandering around. I think it mentioned not using stops for this technique. How do you protect the downside, or you just let it run mechanically with a time stop? You know, the time stop concept is an excellent one. Actually, when we do a lot of our real systems, our mechanical systems, and I want to make a differentiation between a model, okay, a model versus a mechanical system. So that work that I showed you, the five SMA trades and the pinballs and all that type of work, the extended runs, those are models, you know, because we are studying the price behavior, and with a model you can then develop it into a mechanical system. So that's why I said we didn't use stops. In our real world trading, when we were doing that mechanically, we actually used a volatility breakout system to take us out of the trade, to stop us out of the trade, because that had a positive expectation in the opposite direction. So it was kind of using two systems simultaneously, and that seemed to work best. But time stops, we found that if you are in a trade for a duration of 7 bars and a hard stop had not been hit, but a profit target had not been hit, that seemed to be the magic number where it said, just get out of the trade. So you can think that time stops of 7 bars really are fairly valuable concept, and I'm glad that you brought that up. Looking at Apple near the open, is that what I mean by 3 bars with the close above the 3rd bar? I'm just going to quickly pull up a daily Apple chart. I was actually watching that today because it was had that nice little goosey flush below that 400 level, and then it came back up above that, and the last time it was below 400, it was only below there for a couple days, so I thought that was pretty significant. But if I look at that daily Apple chart, you'll see that actually it was about, it was 5 trading days ago that you had that obvious little coil and that 3-bar formation there, 3 bars of price overlap. Actually, you had 2 of those in a row. That just shows how tightly that was wound, and then the move that came out of that was significant in terms of its momentum and its potential for an extended run. So yeah, if you look 5 daily days ago in Apple, that's a great example of it. All the information that I've presented, I have to say that probably maybe 10% of it was in Taylor's book. He did not do any work with the breakouts or extended runs or this. What I wanted to do was, since I did such an opposite presentation last time with 1-minute data and volume bars, I'm sure my webinar is archived there, and you'll see it's totally night and day. I didn't want to give the impression that I traded on such a minute time frame, that this really constitutes my basic approach and core to the market. And I actually used to teach it in a 3-day workshop many years ago, and one of these days I'd love to write a book and document it all in there. But at least it gives you a departure point for studying things more on your own and ideas, and see if any of the concepts are useful to you or not. Regarding the DAX, I just simply look at the 5, the 15, the 30, the 60-minute charts of the DAX when I come in and see, gosh, are there any hourly buy divergences that are forming? You know, is there a 120-minute bear flag? Is there a 15-minute bear flag? It's a really nice rhythmic thing for me, even though I know the Euro stocks is a much more liquid vehicle. The DAX seems to have a nice high beta to it, and it's just always helped me more often than not. I mean, there's periods where it dies and ends up in a mire of noise doing nothing as well, but I'll always look to see if there's any significant chart formations on that, because the U.S. session sort of follows Europe in the first hour of the trading day. You know, we're following the money flows from the overnight, and then I notice that after about an hour of the S&P trading, it sort of switches over to where the Asian and European markets or whatever, they're going to start following the lead of the U.S. So that's how I use that. Do you model Taylor against the EM? Okay. again, yes, QE definitely has had an impact on the volatility of the market and the degree of trendiness for the market. But with that said, it still shouldn't change your approach to analysis. And your analysis is based on supply-demand functions. So if QE actually increases demand in some way because there's extra dollars floating around that need to be put to work, okay, or it somehow affects the variable in that shouldn't matter, because we're seeing that in the technicals. We're seeing that we can keep trading above the previous day's high, or you enter into one of these extended run periods, or perhaps so you have downside flushes on the days where they're not doing POMO, but although they're doing it every day now, so it didn't really matter, and that's been arbed out from what I understand anyway. But you see, it doesn't matter. You know, there's always going to be Arab Spring or implosion of Europe or a Japanese tsunami, or, you know, there's always events. There's always tinkering with the markets. They're never pure free markets, you know, but regardless of that, and regardless of the news, and regardless of the fundamentals, you still have basic supply-demand factors during the day that are going to create lows for the day, that are going to create tests. You will find support and resistance and trend. And so, it, you know, you can't think about those things, and don't worry about predicting where we're going to be a year from now. All we care about is how are we going to trade tomorrow? And that's what I want to orient your thinking towards. You know, how are you going to trade tomorrow? What are you going to do in the S&Ps tomorrow? Are you going to look for a retest of today's lows tomorrow? And just start off with that as a basic departure point. And if there isn't anything and you start to have those little three-bar coils, you know, are you going to look to get on board if it looks like there's a trend day unfolding? You know, are we getting the increase in volume and the range expansion and the short-term continuation patterns? So just keep it simple. And I know I presented a lot of information, but the worst thing that I could do would be to do something that caused brain fry. You know, that nobody needs brain fry when they're trading and doing analysis. Please recommend a charting package, a testing package, and a data service. And, you know, that's a loaded question because it all depends on your budget. But I really have to say that TradeStation does a fabulous job of giving you backtesting tools and data that should be perfectly adequate to to work with. And like I said, all the charting packages out there now have exceptional ability to show all the same indicators. I have both a TradeStation and a CQG, and honestly, they look identical. So if I had to pick one where you could have backtesting capabilities too, I would definitely recommend TradeStation because there's such a wealth of ideas and support there. And it's not my favorite trading platform, perhaps, but I don't think you can beat it in terms of the back testing and so forth. How do I get copies of today's slides? I think that I do believe these webinars are archived. I have to just, oh, I guess they get posted onto YouTube. So there you go. Do you ever use GAN analysis to trade? Now, I got a smile because actually GAN was one of my favorite people that I read early on that made a big influence me. And if you read his very initial basic work, 90% of his work till he got dementia and his sickbed, which he lay there for a number of years as I hear, was basic swing trading. And GAN was talking about tests of highs and tests of lows and this concept of the anniversary dates and so forth. And that influenced me no end with looking to exit on tests of highs and looking to take your profits on tests of lows and, you know, the importance of these areas because everybody sees them. So, no, I don't use the GAN lines and all the goofy geometrical stuff, the GAN squares and, you know, that's a brain fry for me. But, you know, GAN was the one who put out there the basic swing trading charts early on and the tests of the highs and the lows, and those are definitely important concepts. Somebody wanted to know if martial arts help with a good mindset for trading, and honestly, I think anything, you know, gardening's a good one. You know, I ride horses now, or playing tennis, or working out at the gym, or walking the dog. Just do something to clear your mind so that you can be fresh the next day. So I don't think there's definitely one thing that is preferable over the other. You know, just as long as you have some outside activity so that you have a balance in your life, and then try and stay healthy and fit, because it's definitely what's your ability to focus or concentrate. You know, that's in part dependent on your physical state. So, you know, I struggle like everybody else with, you know, diet and clean eating and getting the right balance and so forth, but I can always tell, you know, when I get sloppy in life, or, you know, different things, it will start creeping into my bottom line. So that's just me. I don't trade Forex. I trade the CME futures charts. And we're just going to have two or three more questions here, and then we've got books to trade off here. Okay, let's see. Psychology aspects of trading. I'll just give you guys one excellent, excellent book, okay? And that is called, first of all, the book that I'm auctioning off is definitely a good one for psychology of trading, because it's all about your mindset and believing and positive thinking. And there's a great little book that I just brought in for my sidekick called, you can order on Amazon, get this, for under $3. For under $3, you too can have the secret to success. It's called The Famous Little Red Book That Makes Your Dreams Come True. Seriously. Seriously. And I bet you if everybody ordered that, maybe only 10% will follow the three simple directions, okay, to making it work. But order that book for $2.70 or whatever it is on Amazon. You just Google The Little Red Book and you'll see The Little Red Book That Can Make Your Dreams Come True. And the psychological aspects of trading are all about programming your subconscious for success. Program and brainwash your subconscious and then just let it take care of things, okay? Don't get anxious. You know, just trust that your subconscious will do the right thing once you've programmed it, because this is a brutal business. There are periods of flat times, drawdowns, you know, all that kind of good stuff. So I don't know anything about the Weiss waves, blah, blah, blah. So, all right, $1.99 on Kindle. There you go. Let's get on with the show and auction off these books here. I believe it's not an auction. I believe you guys have all been taking copious notes.
Yeah, Linda, you want me to take the screen back and show the questions?
I think I had a request to repeat that.
Yeah, I was just saying I can take the screen back if you're ready, and I'll show the questions, and then you can help me find the answers, okay?
Okay.
So I'm going to put up the PowerPoint with the questions right now. And guys, if you are one of the winners, then I'm going to ask you for your BMT username. That way I can get a hold of you when the webinar is done and get your contact info so we can get the books to you. So just have that ready. And so Linda's going to pick the answers. I'll just read the questions. What is meant by extended run?
There you go. Seven closes on one side of the five SMA. Sol A.
Okay, good job, Sal. And I need your BMT username. And I guess we should probably mention, because I forgot to, that this is for autographed copies of a book that Linda selected titled The Complete Works of Florence Scovel Shinn. So that's the book Linda selected, and that's what you'll be winning today, guys. Okay, let me write down Sal's username. Okay. Go into question two. What is the most important pivot to measure the trend for the day?
Opening price, Doug Schultz.
Okay, congrats, Doug. I need your BMT username. Okay, and here comes question three. Extended runs or persistency of trend become statistically significant after how many closes on one side of the five-period SMA?
There you go, seven. Derek Wong.
Good. Congrats, Derek. Need your username, please. Okay, let me write that down. Okay, question four. What are the drawbacks about running a mechanical system?
Larger drawdowns.
Okay, so is that Jim?
Peter.
Yeah. Okay, so Jim, I need your BMT username.
Yeah, inherently you have to have wider stops.
Okay, so just waiting for, all right, there it is. And question five. What are the pros about running a mechanical system?
You can get human error running a mechanical system still, but I know what you're saying, and no emotion as well. That's definitely all of these are good answers. The main one that I was looking for was the multiple markets, that you can cover many different markets, whereas a discretionary trader can really only cover a few markets. So right. I would say multiple Thomas. Markets there.
That's Thomas, right?
More markets, Thomas Lejek.
Okay, so Thomas, I need your username. Congrats. Okay. And here comes question number 6. What are the cons about cherry picking a trade such as a 5 SMA trade or pinball?
Less opportunity. There you go. There's less frequency of occurrence. So Benjamin Ramey.
Great. Good job. So I just need your username, Ben. Okay. And question 7. What is a 3-bar triangle pattern?
There you go, higher high than 2 bars ago and lower low than, whoops, got that vice versa, higher low than 2 bars above and lower high than the last 2 days. So Jill got that.
Okay. Congratulations, Jill. I need your BMT username. Okay. And here comes number 8. When is it best to not use the 20-period rate of change for a directional basis?
Actually, that should read 2-period.
Yeah, sorry, 2-period. 2-period rate of change.
There you go. Don't use it when the ranges are narrow.
Okay, so Franz, good job. I need your username. Okay. And here comes question number 9. What is one of the conditions that can lead to an extended run? Okay.
I was looking for a breakout of a chart formation. Breakouts of trading ranges are one proxy, but Franz, you don't need two of these books. Trust me, you only need one. So then I would have to say that one actually pattern that does test out very well is when you've trapped one side on a previous failure. That works good for big chart formations, but that's a good concept, having the false breakouts in one direction can lead to better breakouts on the other.
Okay, so which answer did you want to pick?
Really get a chance and study, like when you do have nice chart formations such as wedges and triangles on the daily chart. Sometimes they unfold over 2 to 3 weeks, and those can just lead to some killer moves.
So Linda, which person did you want to give the book to?
Oh, the trap side on a previous failure there, David. Okay. I think was.
Okay.
You know, that's something also that Wyckoff actually, talked about, the springs and upthrusts, where you have those false breakouts.
Okay. Congrats, David. And here is the last question. Why did Taylor look to hold trades overnight?
Follow through. Overnight follow through.
Okay, so I think that's Shrikinska. I hope I got close on that. I need your BMT username, please, and congratulations on winning a book. All right, so once again, I want to thank Linda for all of her time today to put together the presentation and to stick around for the Q&A and of course, to autograph these books for these 10 winners. So Thanks, Linda, and I hope to see you again.
Thank you, Mike. Sorry for keeping you around so late, but glad everybody stuck it out.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
And good luck trading tomorrow, gang. I think the volatility is going to persist for a while.
Okay. Thanks, Linda. I'll post the recording for this on YouTube tomorrow, guys, so you can check it out there. Thanks. Bye.